Welcome to the Bridge of Truth. I'm extremely pleased to have Anthony Citro back with me. Some of you may recognize Anthony, previous guest. Actually, he was one of the very first guests I had on the Bridge of Truth. We recorded a show, I guess it was about 3.5 years ago.
Seems that quite, long ago.
Quite some time ago.
Welcome, everybody.
Yeah, and little did I know at the time that it would lead to a friendship and we would create an entire series of videos. I would consider them a landmark series on meditations. We began with, I'd like to call the power trio of divine energies.
Violet flame, the Mahatma energy, right?
Yeah, and I am presence. And then we went on last year to finish the entire 12 rays. And
I forced them.
Exactly. And then we did a number of other shows, basically as a follow-up to our very first one. Back in 2010, I guess we were at the beginning of the what would become a media wave of interest mm-hmm. about the end of the Mayan calendar, 12-12-12, all that was going to happen last year. And then we did a show right before that, sort of like to lead into the event. And now here we are a year later, and I guess to many people, it seems like it was much to do about nothing. And so I wanted Anthony to come back because clearly that's not the case. And I know that Anthony's going to be able to explain all of that to us today. So I'd like to welcome our guests. Anthony has been gracious enough to offer to do a meditation, which we will do later on, a meditation for world peace. So welcome, Anthony. Thank you so much for making the trip out here from Brooklyn.
Thank you for having me,
to be a part of this. How would you like to begin?
When we talked about coming back for the end of year, immediately thought, well, 12-12-12. Now we're coming up on 12-12-13. And sort of we're in the first year of the new age, if you will, coming up on that 12-21-12 sort of Mayan moment that everybody thought the end of the world and what was going to happen. And I thought it would be good to sort of take a step back and look at where we are spiritually at the bigger picture, because I think that's really the key to moving forward. Mm. You know, my teacher always said, when you're ready to take a leap spiritually, you take two steps back and then you take a running jump. So you take two steps back and you run. And I think because there's certain, you know, we go a certain level, then we have to, our system has to integrate, and then we can process and move forward. And so I'm assuming most people who watch will be aware, but in case you don't, briefly, when we talk about 12-12-12, we're talking about what's called a Stargate energy, a Stargate date. What is that? Briefly stated, it's not the show with Richard Dean Anderson, it's the show. It is a portal in time, if you will. It is actually a significator of another level of divine unfolding that we can consciously access, those of us who are aware or adept enough to understand. Now, everybody gets the download, as we call it, of information and light coding or whatever you want to say, but it's the light worker's job and the light worker's birthright and joy should be to consciously access it so you can receive even more and then expand in consciousness and help others to do so who are as less able to at the time, at any one time. And so 12-12-12 was a powerful, powerful, what's called a triple Stargate. So it's like when you're in Las Vegas or in one of the slot machines, you're cherry, cherry, there's another cherry, bing, 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 bing. And in terms of spiritual downloading and energy and consciousness shifting, that was a big one. And as you know, we've been doing a lot of shows, and we talked about the harmonic convergence in 1987 and how that sort of precipitated the Mahatma coming into consciousness and the galactic alignment starting to unfold. And then 25 years later, we were sitting with Stephanie doing that show, talking about all that that means in terms of it's just mirroring and showing how fast we're accelerating from 0 to 100 within a space of 20, 25 years, where before that we took lifetimes to just to get one step. And so that's what ascension is when we say ascension. And so these Stargate dates like 10, 10, 10, 11, 11, 11, 12, 12 are all like wake-up calls. You know, when you look at a clock and people say, oh, I see 333 every time I look at a clock, or I see 111. It's because you're awakening. It's showing you that you're awakening. So on a cosmic scale, that's what this is. And so we can know that as we align more with the galactic center, and we even see this scientifically how the planets are lining up. So it's not just a sort of an esoteric thing. It's all encompassing. We are able to receive and access more light cone information. Of course, this happens at all levels and layers of our being. Most of it's unconscious. However, as you know, and those of you who have been following with the energies of creation, as you access the energies consciously, you receive more and more and more and more and more. Mm. You expand your consciousness. You become a brighter light. You attract more moths to your flame. You're in more divine service, whatever form that is. And so what does that all mean? I do just want to talk briefly, because it's so significant, that we had these solar flares last year. We had that rare Venus transit. We had this year the rising star, the Star of David, formed in the sky twice. We have had all these rare astrological influences, and I'm going to refer to my notes because I want to make sure I get everything in.
Absolutely. I know the comet just recently.
Right? Yeah, I'm going to talk about the comet because it's important. And so here we are now, coming up on 12-12-2013, a year later. 13 is the divine feminine. So this is sort of like the first year, if you will, of the new age unfolding. So all the astrological, numerological significators, if you will, indicators are just mirroring back to us where we are. And so that's what we mean by that. We're always receiving download from source, but on certain peak times, we receive even more, or we have the ability to receive even more. And so I encourage anyone on 12-12-12, particularly 12-12-13, if you are at home, or in, like I'm doing a workshop in New York, those who come will receive a strong dose, or if you do it on your own, or you're involved in a meditation group on a webinar, or whatever you do, do something to really connect, to allow and access your highest energies. And then it will filter down through your higher self to your lower personality self and transform as it will over time. We're not always conscious of that, but we feel it and we sense it. And then we can help others do the same. And so I thought, we're in this first year, and it seems like nothing's changed, or everything's changed for the worse. And I want people to understand, to step back and understand that we're in a transition time. We're in what I like to call the Moses zone. And I talk about this to lightworkers all the time. I say, look, we have only so much time in this incarnation where we die and we come back, or we don't come back, or whatever that's going to be. And so we have the opportunity as lightworkers to be like Moses. We'll get to the promised land, but we probably won't cross over into it, or we're taken up, if you will, in this lifetime. But that doesn't mean, as way showers, we don't have a tremendous grace to consciously access that which most people are asleep with.
Do you mean by that we won't get full consciousness by being Moses?
No, what I'm saying is we might not experience the full effects of the golden age, but we can help bring people there.
Yes.
Because we, you know, things are still unfolding. There's still a tremendous amount of resistance to it. So, but we have the consciousness and we incarnate it in this lifetime to show the way. So it's about having that understanding and always holding that high consciousness that we may not see the full effect of it, like the golden age in 100, 200, 300 years where things really shift, hopefully, but we can affect a tremendous change. So we burn off a tremendous amount of karma, we ascend and we elevate a tremendous way, and we offer a tremendous amount of service. So it's all around a grace. So whereas majority of people are asleep, we could be fully awake amongst them, and we can precipitate and affect great change and leave behind that and open up, you know, more good karma for ourselves and other people that we meet along the way. So it's a continuum, and people shouldn't be discouraged because there's so much discord seemingly in the world. But how do we handle that? How do we deal with that? And I want to talk about a little about that. Mm. I do want to mention the comet Ison. In September 2012, it was discovered by scientists, and people thought it was Nibiru, the 12th planet. Interestingly, 12th planet. Mm. Some people thought it was, thought they were, it was going to just, you know, circle around the Earth and reorbit. And really its mission, Diana Patricia Cota-Robles talked about today in her emailing. The comet ISON, scientists know, was of the same stuff 4,500,000,000 years ago when the Big Bang happened, supposedly in alignment with our solar system. So it's the stuff of what we are made of, right, in a sense. Now, it broke away, and it has never been in our solar system until just now. But it's been traveling all this time. In other words, it kept the purity of the initial light codes. See, everything's connected karmically, planet, cosmically, humanly. Everything's connected. So as we fell from grace over time, as we went through the process of all we went through and now coming back to light, it's time now that it's entering our solar system. It's another sign from the universe that another thing is coming, another wave is coming. Now, a comet breaks through old paradigms. And so spiritually and cosmically, it's doing that. And interestingly enough, on Thanksgiving, it crashed into the sun, impacted, and created a big, huge explosion of light, which on a spiritual level helped activate Christ consciousness in our pineal gland because the wave it creates. Now, scientists will see it as an effect physically, but it reverberates spiritually too. So along with the solar flares and the astrological alignments and the 12-12-12 and the 11-11-11, all these indicators are sort of coming into strong focus because we're in that time. So that's what it just means overall. It's really just a way of saying what's unfolding for those who are aware. But they do have effects. You know, the solar flares do affect us. The planetary alignments do affect us. The comets passing through do affect us. And so it's just another sign of our awakening. And so 12 is a power number. It's actually the most powerful number in a sense that we can consciously access because there's 12 rays, the Council of 12. Right. Everything in spiritual government and physical government mirrors that 12 energy.
12 months, 12 astrological signs when you tie it in.
12 nights at the round table, 12 apostles, 12 people on a jury.
Well, that's why the 12-12-12 is such a particularly powerful
it's a combination of three. So you have three, which equals manifestation. Six is mastery. Nine is completion. So then you have completion plus. So therefore, you have that heavenly value. It's like, and then when you have it three times in your face, 12, 12, 12, it's sort of like an overload of that energy. Like there's no, what Source is saying to us is there's no going back. And even though the resistance is still ratcheting up and entrenched, in fact, we're doubling down. You even hear in politics, double down, because that fear of actually changing before you actually change. And that's why it's important for light workers to hold a high consciousness for everybody else's until they come around. But that whole point of the Christ consciousness awakening us, and it's happening anyway in spite of us. So the point is we're in the first year. It's like the new birthing, a new beginning, if you will, the golden age. And it's fraught with tension. It's fraught with discord. It's fraught with uncertainty, just like a newborn, a new life is. It's fragile. And all this stuff that we see ratcheting up, the terrorism, the anti-gay, the anti-woman, the animal abuse, all this stuff, it's very important for us not to be immune to it and say, oh, well, all is well. And I'm not one of these people that believe all is well. And you just close your eyes like a Stepford wife. That's not a solution. You have to maintain positivity, but you also have to embrace what's going on and where you're at. In other words, we incarnated in this lifetime for some divine purpose to help transition this energy. And so it doesn't mean you can't have a great life, you can't have eat great meals, you can't have great sex, you can't be in this or that or whatever, but you have to come, we have to come from a higher consciousness. So this 12-12-13 stargate that's coming up will help us re-examine from the consciousness of the divine feminine now how we have to move forward. And why we're seeing this ratcheting up of all this stuff is because all the old paradigms that were put in place are either coming under drastic review or are leaving us and people that are entrenched in them are resisting because they're comfortable, because they're control the masses and so forth and so on. And so the two biggest ones are technology and religion, because those are two of the major areas of focus that most people have attached to or have need of. You know, we have a long history of religious belief that even now people are, you know, still entrenched in. Technology, if it's unbridled and unchecked, can create a lot of problems, as we've seen. So people, we need technology. You know, even me, I don't want to spend 20 years on a line. I want to flip the card and go through. But we never had that. When I was young, we didn't have cell phones. We didn't have game stations. We didn't have all these things that kids have today. We just played out in the yard till our mother told us to come inside, and we used our imagination, and we actually related to people. And so now you have this, creating this culture of separation almost at the very time when we have to be united. So there's this factor, sources pushing us and is guiding us to say, no more, we're going to connect, we're going to align, we're going to source. And yet our ego part of us is still resisting that because it has to put away the toys, stop playing in the sandbox, and awaken and do something different than we've done.
Well, I don't necessarily consider that we have to put the toys away. We just have to use them for the proper purposes. I mean, this is one of the things that drove me to begin my own spiritual journey and to create the Bridge of Truth, was the feeling that neither religion nor science were being used for humanity's greatest good. And they both have a purpose. It's just that I don't think that we're living up to the purpose.
You bring up a good point. It's not so much the purpose, it's the consciousness behind it. And that's what I always try to teach. And that's what I do with the energy of creation. No matter what you're doing, religious, science, even light work, anything you're doing that you're involved in, if you're coming from a consciousness of separation or domination, it doesn't matter how, there's always going to be well-meaning people in religion, in science. There's always going to be bad people in any area of life, even light work. But it's the consciousness as a whole that needs to shift. And this is what these stargates and these energy streams and these significators, these comets and whatever, are trying to awaken us to. If you are a scientist from a place of Christ consciousness, you're going to do really good stuff in the world. Science is the vehicle. It's not an end in itself. And you're not going to may perhaps be overly greedy and overly charge billions of dollars for every part of a rope, whatever, you know. If you are a religious person and you're coming from a place of inclusion, you're going to have to revisit your belief systems, because religion always was based on separation. My book is right, your book is wrong. My God is the right God, your God's the wrong God. People still to this day are living and dying and killing over something that is not even know if it's real per se or how much it was distorted. So it's the consciousness overall of humanity that is in radical resistance and yet radical awakening at the same time. And so what's a light worker to do? How do we handle that? And again, we ourselves as light workers go through the, oh, it's so much to deal with, it's so overwhelming, I'm just going to, you know, say all is well and go, I'm Shanti, and sit in my meditative cave. But we can't do that anymore. The source is pushing us more than anybody to get out there and go amongst the heathen, if you will, and witness in a way by your example, by what you do, and more importantly, the consciousness you hold. So ascension, we say, is intention. You know, our intention is our ascension. If you want to ascend, you will. If you want to evolve, you will. If you don't, we're becoming more and more powerful, no matter who we are. But most of the people that are becoming powerful still want to go the route of the secret, get the money, win the lottery, as opposed to be in divine service first. So if you're in divine service first, and you then create a wealth, which you then share with those who need it as well, it's a different consciousness and a different outcome than if you hoarding and I'm going to use the secret to make a lot of money because I'm the law of attraction. I'm going to think I'm going to make a lot of money. And then what, you know? So that's where we're at. We're in this crisis of consciousness. We've created a culture of crisis rather than a culture of compassion. We expect war. We expect death. We expect derision. We expect people to get mugged. We expect, you know, the news media feeds fear-mongering like nobody's business. Which is fine for somebody like you and I or somebody who's aware, but middle America is believing it hook, line, and sinker.
But it's not even fine for us because it alters our energies.
brings you down.
Yeah, or, absolutely.
Yeah. So, and this is where we're at. And how do you handle that? How do we handle that? It's a tough question. The first thing you have to do, there's three steps to mastery as I see it in terms of spirituality right now. The first is to master your own judgments, which are very hard. It's very hard to do in the beginning because we've come from lifetimes of separation. We've come from growing up in one way or one tradition that we're comfortable with that says everybody else is wrong. Everybody else's way is bad. And so, the only way is to go within. That's why spiritual teachers will tell you, go within, stay within, come from stillness, because it's the only way you can align to even know. Otherwise, you're just going by rote with what your mother, father said, or how you were taught, or et cetera, and wondering why you're not getting this, that, or the other thing that you want. And so when we go through the process of mastering our own fears, mastering our judgments, mastering that level of consciousness, we start to develop the second level, which is equanimity, maintaining balance, and authentically. Again, it's easy to say, oh, all is well, or that's their journey, and turn a blind eye, and then act like everything's okay. But is that part of the solution, or is it part of the problem? Are you just if you hold a certain power and consciousness, what are you doing for that? How are you, if that's come to you as a lesson or a gift or a grace, how are you dealing with that? Are you just shunting it aside like everybody else does and not doing anything about it and just letting it happen? But then again, it's hard because you're overwhelmed by the amount of abuse and neglect and craziness that's out there. Where do you fight your battle? Where do you pick your battle to fight? Not all of us can be Mother Teresa 24 hours a day. In service, we have lives to live, we have rent to pay, we have families to feed. And then the third level is really about practicing coming from that consciousness. And that's where my work a lot has come in with the energy of creation, because that is consciousness. You are the energy of creation. And so as the law of attraction preaches, when you're in alignment, you'll feel good things will happen automatically. Well, actually what you're doing by connecting with the energies consciously is you are aligning, as opposed to ignoring that which you are, the real you. And you'll see in the meditation we'll do a little bit later on, to really connect with the world seen in terms of world peace, you have to align with that within yourself first and understand and feel at a visceral level just simply that connection with everything else, whether you do something about it or not. And that's the starting point. And so, because otherwise, that maxim of you do the same thing over and expect a different result is insanity. If you keep doing the same paradigm, the same thing, the same way, with the power you now have, you're just going to add more to the fuel to the fire. So we have to take the moment to realign with energy directly, even if it's just divine white light in prayer directly. But even we can do it subconsciously if we allow ourselves and we intention to be in alignment. It'll happen automatically. Again, if you do it consciously, it'll be more accelerated, it'll be more enhanced, you'll be able to be more in service, of course. But those three levels are where we're at now, because like I talked about with the Moses zone before, there's not much more we can do. We sort of like we dropped ourselves on a planet. It's like you time zone to another planet and you have to deal with what you have to deal with. We're here now. We may come back a million lifetimes or another lifetime when it's a different situation. But we're here now. The Middle East is in crisis. The climates are changing. Animals are being, species are disappearing. And yet, there's continual, tremendous, divine dispensation and grace given to us, spoon-fed to us all the time. That's what the energies are. Our awareness of the energies are that. The violet flame, where to be able to use that, to be able to consciously connect, maybe rather than reaching for it and praying for it, to actually intention it and to connect with it in the moment and allow it to affect you. And then, of course, in service to help others who can't do it, that is sort of like where you're at in some form or another. Now, people do it in different ways and forms. It doesn't matter. The matter is the essence, the intention, as opposed to just turning a blind eye and going about your business like the ever-ready bunny, sleeping, screwing, and just hoping everything turns out all right, or being dark, which is the other side. And so a lot of these collective things we see, like the 1% as opposed to everybody else being poor, the thousands of people being affected by one dictator still, all these kind of things, it's because collectively we are not awake. If we were awake more collectively, more en masse, if you will, that would happen less because the dark would have less room to work through those souls who are with that for some reason to affect. It's fun. You have to remember as a light worker that you're working hard for the light, but the dark's working just as hard. We're in duality. And another thing I want to point out too, and how to deal with it during this time, this year of change and transition to springboard us into more healthier reality is, you know, we always talk in the light working business about embracing your shadow self, embracing your shadow side. But we don't embrace the shadow reality of things. We tend to, you know, go to pleasure and avert from pain. And so no one wants to deal with, you know, child abuse in Dubai and selling kids into slavery. No one wants to deal with our own country, 30% poverty rate of children. I mean, it's crazy. I mean, you can go on and on because you don't want to be in a negative space too. At the same time, you don't want to be overwhelmed by all the craziness out there. So what do? You can do practical things. Like you can pick a battle, like say you the environment and work practically in that arena or with children or animals. You can do that. That's part of it. You can ladle soup in a soup kitchen. You can't give money away if you're well off. But what you really need to do is hold a consciousness of light. It's different than saying all is well. It's proactively, directly taking a few moments and holding that conscious light and sending that light however you can and coming from the consciousness that you are God. Because Source, in one way or another, and everything in our life is showing that, is not allowing us to get off the hook more and more. At the same time, they're giving us tremendous amount of love, tremendous amount of support. At the same time, they're pushing us tremendously because we need to be in a more advanced. We should already be in the golden age. But people don't believe that. Look at the gun culture in this country. I mean, you have 12-year-old kids, 6-year-old kids walking around with a gun strapped around them. Crazy parent is giving them a gun. You have kids slapping them. You have parents slapping their children to death in the name of Jesus, the babies. You have all these crazy things going on in the world. And people, what do? You know, you could go on Facebook and just, or the news and just see all of it. And so you send light and love to the different areas and then you send them and then you detach because if you attach, you're going to make more of a problem. So in other words, spirit is pushing us into some kind of box where we just have to come to love. We're going to have to, at the end of the damn day, we're just going to have to give up the ghost and come to a space of love. And you know, it's harder, of course, for the male energy, although that's changing, thank God, now because men have to be tough and play football and fight and you know, drink beer and do all this stuff that supposedly a man does. But what is that? You know, to me, it always amazed me how a man, a group of, say, strong men, let's say 10 men, would pick up and beat up on a weakling, somebody who's weaker, and think they were so manly. I mean, to me, that's the height of cowardliness. If you know that you have this tenfold brute strength over somebody that obviously can't defend themselves and you get off on beating them up, how does that make you feel like a man? If anything, that you should be feel like a cow. But that's how men are usually been trained. That's changing now, thank God. Even girls are starting to bully. You hear the mean girl syndrome. So we are in the midst of the battle. In the final analysis, we're in the midst of the battle. And you have chosen, whether you're aware of it or not, to be a warrior of light or a warrior of dark. And it's coming to the, it's not like a fear-mongering thing like the Lord of the Rings, but, you know, battle coming. But in a sense, we're already in that battle. You have to choose sides in one sense, and then you have to spread that light. You know, there's no more going to sleep. You know, it's like we want to go back to sleep for 5 more lifetimes. Oh, 5 more minutes, I'll be up. You know, you do that when you want to get up. A lot of us are like, oh, just 2 more minutes. I want to sleep 5 more. You can't anymore. You just can't. And the more, and it's going to ratchet up more and more until more people get shocked into awakening. And so really, that's where we're at now. That's the core of where we're at. So I highly encourage people not to get discouraged. That's your first step to mastery, not to get discouraged, and to directly connect with light and disseminate in service. You could hold your hands over your heart and send the violet flame to anywhere in the world you want. It takes a few minutes. And ask the Mahatma to heal any situation you want. And then go about your day, because you're only here for a finite amount of time in this form. And there's only so much you can do. Yes, if you want to advance spiritually and get initiated and all those kind of things, of course you can. But for the quote-unquote average person, even if they hold a high quotient of light, if 2% of the world consistently held a 51% level of light, the whole world would change. The dark would go right away. That's how far off we are, but how easy it is in one sense. You know, it really is easy, but just people just don't believe it's possible. You know, I talk about the Santa Claus effect. Santa Claus effect is what, you know, we grow up. Even myself, I didn't want to believe Santa Claus wasn't real till as long as I could, because it feels good. You wait for Christmas, the gifts, the whole drama, the mystery of it. Here I am running around shopping for the babies in my life today, and I'm looking at all these Santa Claus videos, and I'm like, wow, is this even appropriate to give them? Because I don't want to, you know, kids today are so different. But of course I wanted to see Rudolph the Rainbow Reindeer and the dentist and, you know, and all that. And then, you know, I grew up with that, you know, it's beautiful memories, it's Charlie Brown Christmas and all that, Scooby-Doo and all that. But, yeah, I mean, it really is this Santa Claus effect. People live in a vibration of illusion, and then they're, oh my God, I can't believe that politician was crooked. Oh my God, I can't believe that actor did that. Oh my God, can you believe she did? My neighbor, who every time some murder happens, oh, he was the quietest guy in the block, the nicest guy, never knew. You know, we all live in this sort of bubble because we don't want to deal with reality, but that's getting less and less easy to do for everybody. And it's our job as light workers to awaken people in their own, to their own innate light and goodness, and recognize it as one, namaste, the light in me is the light as you. And then let that trickle down, you know, trickle over and reverberate out. And so the light becomes, one light goes off, another light, another light, another light, another light. It's the whole planet's full of light. And that will supplant the dark's domain, which is, you know, this fear, which is ego-based. Yes, you're going to feel things. Yes, bad things are going to happen. But we have to realize, Al, that we create our reality. And this is the hardest thing. We've talked about this before. People to spiritually get is that you're creating your own reality. No one wants to believe they create a bum leg or a soldier coming back from war or whatever, or cancer. But the bottom line is you don't say consciously, I want to do that. It's we're hyper awakening at a rapid rate. And so the resistance has to work itself through, because we still only see one lifetime a lot of times, but this is a drop in the bucket. So there's so many things going on. What's a person to do? Again, just come be in love. I mean, it's really the final analysis. At the end of the day, we're all going to realize the only thing we can do is be love. And it sounds corny, but it's true, because love is light. If you don't have the absence of love, is everything we don't want or we think we want at first, you know, especially in sexual excitement or, you know, over sensual stimulation. But we see time and time again the effects of that. Without a love attached, connected with it. It's not good. It doesn't come to good, let's say. It might be exciting superficially, but it doesn't in the long run prosper anything. And so also we're coming around full circle, speaking of the comet crashing into the sun. You know, 2,000 years ago when JC was around, he precipitated this wave, and that sacrifice and the whole thing brought us through the dark ages to bring us all the way out so we can come back in one fell swoop. And that's what these last 25 years are about. Of course, we don't consciously always process that. But all the sacred symbols, all the modalities, all the teachers that have come about have manifested more and more to hold space until we all hold space. And so I used to do workshops called Holding Light Longer, because people don't even know what holding light means. And it really is just about literally holding light. We have 66,000 thoughts a day, or something like that, 60,000 thoughts. Most of them are negative. Thoughts create reality. We're becoming more powerful and we're creating our reality. So yes, we may have messed up, let's say, up until now, but now we have the opportunity to shift. And this is where the secret started to come about. But of course, it missed the mark in a lot of ways. It was the first step. But you know, we have to take responsibility for creating our own reality. And I encourage people all the time, this is the grandest adventure of your life. Never before in the history of all your lifetimes have you been allowed to be like Merlin. You've been allowed to be Saint Germain. Have you been allowed to create and manifest your destiny moment to moment as magically as you want? Yes, are there challenges? Yes, is there karma to work through? Yeah, those masters certainly faced in their lifetime. But they were such avatars that they kept the high level of consciousness no matter what. And that's why we're so drawn to them, especially somebody as wonderful energy as Merlin or Saint Germain, especially now with the violet flame coming back. We're attracted to them because they mirror to us that we want to be like that. You know, we want to have, and you can. But the only way you can do it is to come from that space of consciousness. And that's the difficult journey now, is to recognize that we are God. That's huge, you know, not in an ego way, that we are source and source is us. And so all this energy, like I look back on my own life and I could say, God, all the energy I wasted doing this or that, or I held back from this and held back from that when I could have been doing it, that comes up because when you become more powerful, you realize what you could have done, but you can't dwell on that. But, you know, it comes up and I think about it. But it's the same thing. We're realizing on a soul level, as a humanity, all that we've done, all that we held back from, all the dark ages, all the wars in the name of God, supposedly, who doesn't want war, all the fighting, all the greed, all the corruption, all the lack of love and compassion, for what? You know, when you could have been living wonderful, you know? And I always tell people, if you want to know about karma, spirituality, study history, because if you know that your karma, you believe in karma, which you should if you're on the spiritual path, in a sense, well, most of our lifetimes were short-lived, disease-ridden, battle-worn, unless you were adept in a, you know, monk or a nun somewhere. And so we come in with that energy in this one short lifetime. We're going to heal all that. And that's why we feel this tremendous call to healing and spirituality and to work through all this stuff. And so we collectively as a soul group call the Mahatma in on a soul level, not a personality level. And so the Mahatma finally came. It wanted to come in when during Atlantis time, but we weren't ready for it. And so it's just part of the divine progression. But we're here now in this lifetime. And, you know, when you have these dates like 12, 12, 12, or, you know, whatever, 11, 11, 11, you know, there are peak times for you to meditate and to bring in alignment and energy and ask for it. But, you know, you can contact the energies every day.
Yeah, well, you just mentioned meditation. And I think we're at a point now yes. in our show where that would be a perfect time to do the meditation that you have.
Absolutely.
Offered to give, because I think it's a wonderful thing to try to, again, keep a positive intention and yet be proactive with your action. So
I'm a big believer in doing something, not just talking about it. So I thought it would be nice to, and you agreed to have this sort of meditation in the broadcast to help people start to put into focus.
Well, particularly connection. World peace, because yeah. it doesn't label, it doesn't demand specifics.
Yeah.
It can be whatever it needs Absolutely. To create world peace and whatever world peace means in, yeah. in your particular.
Well, it's really we're all connected. And so,
because for some world peace is having a cleaner environment. For some world peace is no wars. For some world peace is no child abuse. For some world peace, in other words, whatever that might be, and to have just something that a positive energy for world peace.
Well, I think it's holding the energy for all of it. Yeah. You know, holding the energy for, you know, when we say world peace, we assume that people are eating, sleeping, drinking comfortably in a balanced way, not killing each other,
exactly,
not abusing each other, and just. It's a culture of cooperation, not competition. And that's hard. You know, population explosion is another thing. It's another problem. So again, the more we put energy out into the ethers, if you will, of positivity that way and hold it, you start to see in your own life things shift. And then it sort of bleeds out as you allow.
In my belief system, it's about the alleviation of poverty, conflict, and disease. Very, very simple, basic things that we all need to relieve in order to have an ideal world, a peaceful world.
Yeah.
So, Anthony, why don't we, what do we need to start? Tell us how to prepare for this.
So in a moment, I think you're going to turn the screen to an image, and you could meditate on the image on the screen of the rising star, or you can close your eyes for the minute. The 10 or so minutes will be a meditation, and we'll be connecting with everybody viewing the broadcast or everybody who, you know, you want to connect with. And we'll just do the meditation, and then we'll come back and close up that way. So why don't you get comfortable and hands and legs uncrossed, you know, hands open on your lap, and just close your eyes, take a few deep breaths, and we'll have a moment of silence, and then just follow along with me. And then once I start, you can either open your eyes and look at the image, or you can just keep your eyes closed and listen, and then I'll guide you through it, okay? Sound good? All right, excellent. So would you close your eyes and...
Okay.
And so now, taking three deep life force breaths in through the nose and gently out through the mouth, simply relaxing as best that you can in the moment, at this moment. Each successive breath allowing for a deeper level of stillness. And in this ensuing stillness, a broader awareness of all that is, all that can be. Each successive breath opening you to the understanding more and more, the revelation that as you inhale, Source exhales, and that as you exhale, Source inhales. As you inhale, God exhales. As you exhale, God inhales. Source, God, Goddess, all that is one with you, as you are indeed one with Source. There is no separation. There is only resistance to this realization, to an allowing of heavenly effulgence to be one with you, to be in you and of you, and to radiate outward from you. And as you continue to breathe deeply and evenly, you may now feel your crown chakra, the area atop your head, begin to awaken now. Perhaps your spine tingles a bit, or there is present a slight pressure at the crown, or perhaps at the base of your neck, or the tip of your nose, a gentle heaviness. This is all perfectly natural. As your normal defense mechanisms, which diffuse oftentimes source light given to you, which are afraid unnecessarily of cohesion, of surrender, begin to relax their usual defensive posturing, begin to drop away now, instantly supplanted with a powerful stream of divine white light, which, like water flowing over rocks, streams down now into your crown chakra and into your physical body, filling every vacant space now with this source light. Your battery is being charged. Your light switch is being turned on. Your vibration raised. You are awakening. And as you awaken, similar to sitting in a dark room and then turning on a lamp, your eyes adjusting to the shift in the level of light entering, so too, your inner being now recalibrates to allow a maximum influx of divine white light. Each breath now admitting and submitting to more and more pure source light, cascading now down your spinal column and down through your tailbone and into the earth. Generating and swirling about now throughout your internal organs, your stomach, your liver, your kidneys, your intestines, your heart, now past your genitals and down your legs, and on down through the soles of your feet, sweeping down now as well your arms and into your wrists and through the palms of your hands. Shining forth now out of your eyes and filling now each chakra point, flowing out from each chakra center, front and back, glowing now with this divine source light. And as you continue to integrate light and taking now a deep inhalation of source as source, on the exhalation, let go. The source light now fully flooding and engulfing you. And again, a deep inhalation. Exhaling now as divine source light powerfully moves into your aura, filling your auric structure to capacity. And yet again now, one more deep inhalation all the way into your solar plexus. And now exhaling, the source light within you shines out past your aura's edge, buoying you in a sea of light. Each breath charging this light, building a quotient of light within you far surpassing anything you may have experienced until now. With each new breath, each next moment, source light within you expanding and growing. This is you, the real you. Core source light that has incarnated and focused into form, your form. And so you can now understand perhaps more clearly the concept that we are all one and that everything is connected. And as you sit in sacred stillness, a conduit for source light, you can contemplate that all things, all others, animal and mineral, everything at its core is this same source light. And so you are invited now to gently and easily place your hands over your heart, right over left. Gently place your hands over your heart, right over left. As your hands at your chest focus you in a heart centeredness, allow now whatever amount of this divine white light that you do not need for your own edification, your own divine purpose, to go forth and touch the heart light of your loved ones, those both near and distant and physically far away. For you are connecting at the level of the heart, which generates an electromagnetic intelligence thousands upon thousands of times more potent than the most focused thought. Here is ascension. Here is service. Here is divinity. And as you connect with your loved ones, and you begin to feel the expansiveness of the connected heart, and now full up with source light, allow this connection to expand even further. Connect to all other hearts, however you can, and in whichever amount that you feel comfortable to do so. Both friend and foe alike, support system and competition, authority figure and employee, not forcing anything, even out to all the peripheral people in your daily life, the postman, the local store clerk, the doctor, and the school crossing guard. And as you connect at the heart, their heart lights also begin to glow. If there is any resistance, simply allow it. If any emotion arises, let it flow. And as the light escalates, you can now open your heart. And so gently open your hands at your chest, and extending now your arms wide out and open, your heart's light, incandescent with the energy field of your heart and the source light emanating from you, now embraces the world. and all who inhabit form here. All drops of one consciousness, one source light. All equal in the mind of God. And as you hold your arms extended wide and out and open, source light through you bathes the planet and all upon it in divine white light. This is peace. This is unity. This is the golden age. This is the solution. This is the consciousness level required to hold space for the transformation that is unfolding, the revolution to come. This is the call to love. And so, when you are ready, slowly and gently and easily, lower your arms, resting your palms upright on your lap. If you need to yawn or gently roll your neck, please do so. You may wriggle your toes and fingers. Each breath now, deeper and fuller, bringing you back into the room, back into the present, now into the now.
Well, Anthony, that was wonderful. Thank you so much. It's been an incredible hour. And one thing I'd like to say was coming to me as you were speaking earlier is that I began by referencing the show that we did in 2010 about the end of the Mayan calendar. And last year was the end of the first Mayan long calendar. And the thing that occurs to me, and I don't really hear mentioned much, is that this year is actually the start of the next Mayan long calendar. It's an amazing opportunity. It isn't something where we can expect change to happen overnight, but it is clearly a signal for us to begin a new age, that we all have the opportunity at this point, the very first year of the new Mayan long calendar.
Well, the key is to holding light longer, holding the consciousness longer, and letting that inform your next step. Everything else is the old paradigm, and what will unfold, we'll see.
Yeah. So is there anything else in closing that you'd like to add before we wrap?
Well, I know you're going to graciously, or going to force him to make a video excerpt of the meditation, which will be a more extended time to integrate and all that.
Sure.
That'll be available soon, and then, of course, this will be posted. You know, this was, even in the talking before and what to say and what was channeled and what to think, we're really in that sort of like that phase. And so just embrace that and know that you have the spiritual lifeline of the energies of creation, which you are, to bring you up out of that morass to inform anything you do. It's not separate from anything. Everything comes from it. And so that's what I would say. And just keep on spreading that light and being love.
And
it's that simple.
If anybody would like to get in touch with you, has any questions about what we've discussed, or wants to know more,
go through the website. Please. Yeah. And I'm sure we'll be doing more shows, and things are coming up. I am doing a workshop on 12/12 next week in Manhattan. You can register and take it etherically long distance if you want. It's in the morning, 10 to 1. But maybe somebody in your area, wherever you are, is doing something, or you yourself can get a gathering together.
Well, your website is ascensionlightsource.com.
Ascensionlightsource.com, and it's all listed, and it'll be in the information.
Because clearly, I mean, these videos certainly will extend into time. So whenever somebody happens to be seeing it,
and it's been amazing.
And they want to follow up with Anthony personally, please do so. I've been to many of them and had the opportunity to film several. And they're wonderful experiences, and I certainly would encourage everyone to
sign up for the Meta Center New York's list, because I mostly work out of there unless I travel. And
well, thank you again, Anthony.
Yes, thank you again for the opportunity.
And in closing, then, may all your journeys be truthful. Till the next time we meet on the Bridge of Truth.